Anthem by Ayn Rand. Part 1. It is a sin to write this. It is a sin to think words no others think, and to put them down upon a paper no others are to see. It is base and evil. It is as if we were speaking alone to no ears but our own. And we know well that there is no transgression blacker than to do or think alone. We have broken the laws. The laws say that men may not write unless the council of vocations bid them so. May we be forgiven. But this is not the only sin upon us. We have committed a greater crime, and for this crime there is no name. What punishment awaits us, if it be discovered, we know not, for no such crime has come in the memory of men, and there are no laws to provide for it. It is dark here. The flame of the candle stands still in the air. Nothing moves in this tunnel save our hand on the paper. We are alone here under the earth. It is a fearful word, alone. The laws say that none among men may be alone, ever and at any time, for this is the great transgression and the root of all evil. But we have broken many laws, and now there is nothing here save our one body. And it is strange to see only two legs stretched on the ground, and on the wall before us the shadow of our one head. The walls are cracked, and water runs upon them, and thin threads without sound, black and glistening as blood. We stole the candle from the larder of the home of the street sweepers. We shall be sentenced to 10 years in the palace of corrective detention, if it be discovered. But this matters not. It matters only that the light is precious, and we should not waste it to write when we need it for that work which is our crime. Nothing matters save the work, our secret, our evil, our precious work. Still, we must also write. For, may the council have mercy upon us, we wish to speak for once to no ears but our own. Our name is Equality 7-2521, as it is written on the iron bracelet which all men wear on their left wrists with their names upon it. We are 21 years old, we are 6 feet tall, and this is a burden, for there are not many men who are 6 feet tall. Ever have the teachers and the leaders pointed to us and frowned and said, "There is evil in your bones, Equality 7-2521, for your body has grown beyond the bodies of your brothers." But we cannot change our bones nor our body. We were born with a curse. It has always driven us to thoughts which are forbidden. It has always given us wishes which men may not wish. We know that we are evil, but there is no will in us, and no power to resist it. This is our wonder and our secret fear, that we know and do not resist. We strive to be like all our brother men, for all men must be alike. Over the portals of the palace of the World Council, there are words cut in the marble, which we repeat to ourselves whenever we are tempted. We are one and all in one. There are no men, but only the great we, one, indivisible and forever. We repeat this to ourselves, but it helps us not. These words were cut long ago. There is green mold in the grooves of the letters, and yellow streaks on the marble, which come from more years than men could count. And these words are the truth, for they are written on the palace of the World Council, and the World Council is the body of all truth. Thus has it ever been since the great rebirth, and farther back than that no memory can reach. But we must never speak of the times before the great rebirth, else we are sentenced to 3 years in the palace of corrective detention. It is the old ones who whisper about it in the evenings. in the home of the useless. They whisper many strange things of the towers which rose to the sky in those unmentionable times, and of the wagons which moved without horses, and of the lights which burned without flame. But those times were evil, and those times passed away, when men saw the great truth, which is this, that all men are one, and that there is no will save the will of all men together. All men are good and wise. It is only we, Equality 7-2521, we alone who were born with a curse. For we are not like our brothers. And as we look back upon our life, we see that it has ever been thus, and that it has brought us step by step to our last, supreme transgression, our crime of crimes hidden here under the ground. We remember the home of the infants, where we lived till we were 5 years old, together with all the children of the city who had been born in the same year. The sleeping halls there were white and clean and bare of all things, save 100 beds. We were just like all our brothers then, save for the one transgression. We fought with our brothers. There are few offenses blacker than to fight with our brothers, at any age and for any cause whatsoever. The council of the home told us so, and of all the children of that year, we were locked in the cellar most often. When we were 5 years old, we were sent to the home of the students, where there are 10 wards for our 10 years of learning. Men must learn till they reach their 15th year. Then they go to work. In the home of the students, we arose when the big bell rang in the tower, and we went to our beds when it rang again. Before we removed our garments, we stood in the great sleeping hall, and we raised our right arms, and we said all together, with the three teachers at the head, "We are nothing, mankind is all. By the grace of our brothers are we allowed our lives. We exist through, by, and for our brothers, who are the state. Amen." Then we slept. The sleeping halls were white and clean and bare of all things, save 100 beds. We, Equality 7-2521, were not happy in those years in the home of the students. It was not that the learning was too hard for us. It was that the learning was too easy. This is a great sin, to be born with a head which is too quick. It is not good to be different from our brothers, but it is evil to be superior to them. The teachers told us so, and they frowned when they looked upon us. So we fought against this curse. We tried to forget our lessons, but we always remembered. We tried not to understand what the teachers taught, but we always understood it before the teachers had spoken. We looked upon Union 5-3992, who were a pale boy with only half a brain, and we tried to say and do as they did, that we might be like them, like Union 5-3992. But somehow the teachers knew that we were not, and we were lashed more often than all the other children. The teachers were just, for they had been appointed by the councils, and the councils are the voice of all justice, for they are the voice of all men. And if sometimes, in the secret darkness of our heart, we regret that which befell us on our 15th birthday, we know that it was through our own guilt. We had broken a law, for we had not paid heed to the words of our teachers. The teachers had said to us all, "Dare not choose in your minds the work you would like to do when you leave the home of the students. You shall do that which the Council of Vocations shall prescribe for you. For the Council of Vocations knows in its great wisdom where you are needed by your brother men, better than you can know it in your unworthy little minds. And if you are not needed by your brother man, there is no reason for you to burden the earth with your bodies." We knew this well, in the years of our childhood, but our curse broke our will. We were guilty, and we confess it here. We were guilty of the great transgression of preference. We preferred some work and some lessons to the others. We did not listen well to the history of all the councils elected since the great rebirth. But we loved the science of things. We wished to know. We wished to know about all the things which make the earth around us. We asked so many questions that the teachers forbade it. We think that there are mysteries in the sky and under the water and in the plants which grow. But the Council of Scholars has said there are no mysteries, and the Council of Scholars knows all things. And we learn much from our teachers. We learned that the earth is flat, and that the sun revolves around it, which causes the day and the night. We learn the names of all the winds which blow over the seas and push the sails of our great ships. We learned how to bleed men to cure them of all ailments. We loved the science of things, and in the darkness, in the secret hour, when we awoke in the night, and there were no brothers around us, but only their shapes in the beds and their snores, we closed our eyes, and we held our lips shut, and we stopped our breath, that no shudder might let our brothers see or hear or guess, and we thought that we wished to be sent to the home of the scholars when our time would come. All the great modern inventions come from the home of the scholars, such as the newest one, which was found only 100 years ago, of how to make candles from wax and string, also how to make glass, which is put in our windows to protect us from the rain. To find these things, the scholars must study the earth, and learn from the rivers, from the sands, from the winds and the rocks. And if we went to the home of the scholars, we could learn from these also. We could ask questions of these, for they do not forbid questions. And questions give us no rest. We know not why our curse makes us seek. We know not what, ever and ever. But we cannot resist it. It whispers to us that there are great things on this earth of ours, and that we can learn them if we try, and that we must know them. We ask, why must we know? But it has no answer to give us. We must know that we may know. So we wished to be sent to the home of the scholars. We wished it so much that our hands trembled under the blanket.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.